Let's write our first example. This will be a request reply example. We're going to send a number from request to the reply socket, and we'll return the square of that number. Now, if you've properly installed the libraries via Vcpkg, and you've done Vcpkg integrate install, and you're matching the bit versions, I'm in x64 there, and I have the x64 libraries installed, you'll be able to find ZMQ add-on.hbp. Note that the context is global. Typically, contexts can be shared and should be shared, but there are situations where you're not going to share the context. Contexts are used to derive sockets. Okay, so there we derive a request socket from the global context, and then we connect that socket over TCP to endpoint 5555. Note the word connect there. Then in our event loop, all we're going to do is generate a random number, implement a bit of a speed bump in there. That's why I'm getting the chrono library in there. We don't want to overwhelm the reply side, and also we want to see what's going on. So a tiny 100 millisecond speed bump there. Pull in random. So here we'll generate a random integer and convert it to a string. Then we're going to create a ZMQ message from that string, and then we can send it out over the socket. Now, typically you'll have some kind of a serialization mechanism there. At a minimum, you'll have JSON, but usually in production environments, you're going to have some kind of a binary serialization thing going on, like Protobuf or Microsoft Bond, which we're going to take a look at later in this series. Now, the important thing to note here is that the send must be followed up by receive. You can have multiple sends and multi-part messaging here, but for a request socket, you must finish it off with a receive. It is implemented as some kind of a finite state machine. So to complete that cycle, the receive must be there after a send. You cannot have a series of sends with never receiving. And the same is true for the reply socket, but in a different order. The receive on the reply side must be followed by a send, and you'll see that in a bit. So all we're doing here is generating a random integer, converting it to a string, putting it into a ZMQ buffer, sending it over the socket, and waiting for a message in return. Now I have a bit of a typo in there. I have Z out to string view. You have to be careful with messages after they're sent out. So ZMQ messages, after they've been sent out, the guts are removed from them. So there's nothing in there anymore. Okay, ZMQ messages, ZMQ sockets, and ZMQ contexts are movable. So you have to be careful with them. So consider messages, ZMQ messages, after they've been sent, those objects, you need to consider them stale. On the server side, the mechanics are quite similar. Instead of a request socket, we have a reply socket, but notice that we are binding the reply socket. And this is a ZMQ convention. Client sockets are connected, server side sockets are binded. Okay, and that is not always clear in a lot of scenarios. So over time, you develop an understanding of which sockets are connected and which sockets are binded. Now the receive command is a blocking command. And when we start this application, the server side application with the reply socket, it's going to block on receive until it receives a message from the client. and to reiterate the reply socket to complete the cycle. After a receive, you must do a send. Let's start up the server-side application first. And you can see that the information is being returned. Just to make things more explicit, that activity is going on the reply side. Let's have something get printed out on the server side, the reply side as well. If you enjoyed this video, consider subscribing and hit the like button. Thank you.